All right, welcome to the latest Real Health webinar. You know, I've got my first slide up there just so that you know you're in the right place. 10 steps to renew your energy and regain your life. And as always, I'm your host, Dr. Taylor Crick, here with the Real Health Resource and the latest Real Health webinar on 10 steps to renew your energy and regain your life. And this is an awesome, awesome topic because I would say that it applies for everyone. Everyone can bear to have more energy in their life and imagine the things that you'll be able to do. And so that's why I said regain your life. For so many of us, you know, we just get bogged down with low energy. And one of the reasons that I really like this topic too is for so many of us, we don't really know it. Okay, we don't really know that we're just getting bogged down with low energy, with fatigue, because it comes on so slowly. And when you look around you, everybody else is doing about the exact same thing. You know, you go to the park with your kids, most of the parents are sitting down on the park bench. You go to the mall, a lot of husbands are sitting down because we just don't have any energy. We're just bogged down. And so many people in our practice, they don't come in with low energy or fatigue being one of their primary complaints. But then when we reevaluate with them, we ask them what has changed, it's almost every single person will say that they have dramatically more energy. And I can speak to this personally. I tell a lot of people this, that, you know, last January of 2016, if you would have asked me how healthy I was on a scale of 1 to 10, I would have thought I was pretty close to a 10. You know, nobody's perfect, but how I felt was a 10. I had no complaints. I skied 2 to 3 times a week and woke up at 4:30 in the morning to do that. And really, you know, just no complaints, thought I felt great. Then I started implementing some of the things that we're going to talk about in today's webinar. Some of these 10 steps and some of the advanced versions that we're going to talk about in the 10 webinars to come, because today we're going to talk about 10 steps. We're going to briefly skim over them, but each of them is a webinar unto itself. Each topic that we're going to talk about is a webinar unto itself. So that's what we're going to follow up with in the next 10 months, is 10 webinars on these 10 steps, because I feel that anybody can have the changes that I felt. And so, like I was saying, I implemented some of these steps that we're going to go into detail on, and all of a sudden I didn't realize that there was an 11. That there was a 12, that there was a 13. I just kept feeling better. And I had so much energy. People around me noticed, my wife noticed. I was reading books. I was playing in the yard with the kids, gardening. And I was never, you know, a couch potato to begin with, but it was a noticeable change and it was amazing. And every single person out there, if you're an Olympic athlete, I think you would know more than most that more energy, even 5%, 10% more energy could absolutely benefit you. I want to tell one more story before we started getting into the slides here. But another patient, he came in, he did a lot of changes, changed some of his diet, went grain-free with his diet, started eating a real food diet to begin with, then grain-free, then went through excuse me, then went through our True Cellular Detox program. And his changes were dramatic. You know, he didn't come in with any complaints necessarily either, but maybe knew that he wasn't as healthy as he possibly could be. And he lost about 30 to 40 pounds, I would say, and maintained keeping that off. But through some of the supplemental protocols, through some of the dietary changes, help from work, I would sit, used to be completely normal. But after 10, 20 minutes, it almost felt like I couldn't stay there, like I couldn't continue sitting on the couch because I had so much energy, I had to get up and do something. So with that being said, you know, let's get into the 10 steps to renew your energy. And first thing that I want to do is show you that, you know, that this is a problem, okay? I think that Americans have an energy crisis. And that's not talking about oil or natural gas or solar power. That's talking about getting out of bed and doing the things that we love with life and vitality. This is most people today. It's not that you're absolutely dragging, that you're falling asleep, that you're narcoleptic, but you don't even realize it, that you don't have the energy that you used to have. And I'll use the example when we get to steps number one and steps number two of just, you know, looking at if you are carrying, say, an extra 20 or 30 pounds around. Okay, if you've ever worn a weight vest, you know, sometimes I'll wear one just as an illustration, a 20-pound weight vest. And if you wear that thing around for 10 minutes, you're exhausted. So that alone goes to say that most people, if they lose 10 or 20 pounds, could have a huge boost in energy. But we have an absolute energy crisis today, and most people don't even know it. Now, here's the people that do know it. Okay, so there's over 6 million doctor's visits each year with fatigue as the primary complaint. Okay, so people notice that they are noticeably enough fatigued that they need to go to the doctor for it. Chronic fatigue syndrome, that's a pretty heavy diagnosis that we've seen, you know, several people in the office be diagnosed with chronic fatigue alongside fibromyalgia, things like that, CME oftentimes it's called. So that's a million people. So still, that's not very many. Hypothyroidism, which one of the big symptoms of hypothyroidism is low energy. Well, there's 27 million people with diagnosed thyroid diseases. So that's hyper, that's hypo, but over 25 million, some say more like 40 plus million. Depression, one of the major signs of depression is fatigue, right? You just feel so sad that you can't get out of bed, and you maybe, you know, have seen the commercials of the cartoon walking around sulking, and they offer the antidepressant. And we're going to talk about that in one of the steps, about one of the causes of that and how it's related to low energy and what you can do about that. And then fibromyalgia is another example. I said that's often linked with chronic fatigue. But, you know, 5 to 10 million diagnosed, confirmed with fibromyalgia. So we can tell that that is a big issue with our energy crisis here. So what can you do about it? That's the most important thing, is action. What can you do about fatigue? So I want to get right into the steps that you can take. And before that, you know, I want to just mention that is, you know, people with diagnosed conditions. But like I said at the beginning, I'm talking more to those of us without a diagnosis, or to those of us that aren't going to the doctor, and probably the most, I'm talking to those of us that don't even know it. Okay, so most of you out there don't even know that you have a fatigue issue, but if you start taking these action steps, you're gonna notice a dramatic change. The last thing I wanna mention is that these steps go in order. Okay, so we're gonna skim the surface on each one. There's a handout, there's a PDF that you can download that goes along with this webinar, that has some notes, that has some follow-up things, has some podcasts that you can listen to on www.realhealthresource.com, some articles that you can read, supplements that we recommend. Those are in the PDF that you can download. But stay tuned over the course of the next several months as we start to release each one of these steps as its own webinar. We're going to dive into each one of these steps. Okay, so with that being said, number one, the number one thing that you can do, and like I said, these are in order, so this is a bare bones basic. This is a must for anyone that wants to have, you know, even a good amount of energy, is eat a real food diet. And if you followed anything that we post on the Real Health Resource before, you know that that's a huge thing for us. Eat a real food diet. When you are eating a junk food diet, you're clogging up your body's energy. It's kind of like putting junky gas into a rocket or a race car. You know, they use higher quality gas because they need higher energy for those automobiles. And when you're putting junky fuel in, you're getting junky energy. And the fact of the matter is, in today's society in America, 90% of the calories that we consume are processed, while 60% of the calories that our country consumes, 60% of the calories are what's called ultra processed. And that's like gas station food. Okay, so bad foods, what they lead to is they lead to weight gain. That's the most obvious thing. They lead to poor blood sugar control. They lead to inflammation. Okay, and inflammation is going to affect your cellular energy, step number 10. It's going to affect your adrenal energy, which is one of the steps. It's going to affect your thyroid. It's going to affect your hormone communication, along with just adding on the weight vest that we talked about. If you're eating a junk food diet, causing a leaky gut, causing food allergies, causing inflammation, but the simplest of all, just causing weight gain in most American people, that's like putting on a 20, 30, 40, 50 pound weight vest and trying to get through your day. Just getting up a flight of stairs with a 20 or 30 pound weight vest is exhausting. So imagine the relief that you feel when you lose that. So losing some weight this year could be a great goal. And if it starts with just eating a real food diet. Just by changing to a real food diet, you're going to automatically lose weight if you're overweight. Now, it might not happen in a week, and it might not even happen in a month. But if you know that you have weight to lose, you start to eat a real food diet and implement step number two, which we're going to go through in a second here. You do these two simple steps, you start to take those weight vests off, your energy is going to go through the roof, then maybe you have the energy to go to the gym, then maybe you have the energy to go to the grocery store and take a little bit longer getting the right foods, getting the right groceries, walking around the farmer's market, but it has to start with a real food diet. Now, if you're wondering what is a real food diet, well, here's a very, very simple thing. Is did this grow somewhere or did this get packaged and processed somewhere? And even if it's in a box and it says potatoes, that doesn't mean that it's potatoes. But if you're holding something in your hand and it's brown and the inside is white and it's kind of hard, that's a potato. We all know it's the thing that's on the outside of the box. That's not the real food. The real food is the real food. So eat vegetables, eat fruits, eat naturally grown meats, naturally raised, organically raised, preferably grass-fed, pasture-raised animal products. Eat fruits and vegetables. Real food. Canned corn. If you're starting from, you know, a very sick place where you eat, you're like the 60% ultra processed gas station type food, sure, go with the can, but otherwise buy the real food. Eat food by God and not food by man. That is the most simple step. That is the foundation of regaining your energy. And you can't expect to regain your energy if you're not eating a real food diet. So once you've done that, once you've started to eat a real food diet, step number two is exercise regularly and the right amount. Okay, and I put that up in there for a specific reason that, you know, you don't want to exercise once or twice or three times or for a month. You want to exercise regularly. Even if that's 2-3 times a week, exercising regularly is going to help change and transform your body's energy systems. It's going to change and transform and help improve your blood sugar control, which is going to help with your energy long term, how many crashes and spikes you have. It's going to help with your hormone sensitivity. It's going to help with basically everything. It's going to balance your sleep cycles, which is one of our next steps coming up. But exercising regularly makes a world of difference. You can exercise daily. You can exercise every other day. It kind of depends on what you're doing. You know, if you're really breaking down a lot of muscle, then the recovery time is just as important. And that's exactly why I put on that slide the right amount, because there's those people out there who are high level athletes, but their energy is just down, you know, in the gutter. And that is comes from a syndrome really called overtraining. Or really, you know, I'd say just a problem called overtraining, but there is an overtraining syndrome. But, you know, what that means is that you're not giving your body enough time for rest and recuperation. And I know some people who, you know, are ultra-long runners who have struggled with this. I know some people who are weightlifters at the competitive level and have struggled with this. But overtraining burns out your adrenal glands, and we're going to talk about that later, too. And you know, that's a similar thing to non-athlete, an average person, just getting burned out after, you know, one day it's one coffee, the next month it's two coffees, the next month it's three coffees and a nap. And then before you know it, they're energy is just in the gutter, and they feel like they have to be one of the 6 million people who go to the doctor with that as their primary complaint. That happens at a faster rate when you're a hardcore athlete. I always like to say the movement. Okay, that's not really exercise. Give your heart, give your lungs a really good workout. You can do things like surge workouts, which is one of the things that I encourage, you know, 10 to 15 to 20 minutes a day. You do things like ride a bike. You can do things like go for a run. You can do things like lift weights. But you can do all these with a surge type principle. So when we have the follow-up webinar for step number two, exercise regularly and the right amount, we'll go into a little more detail on some of the hormonal shifts that you can do, some of the things you can do to help balance your sleep cycle with exercising regularly. And I got to tell you, it's not going to take very much time. It's not going to take very much effort, really. It's going to take this and doing regularly, but we're going to make it easy for you and show you how you can get the proper hormonal response to have good long-term changes with your energy system. But once you're eating a real food diet, exercising regularly, those are the two things that, you know, if you're not doing those already, then I would say start there to change your energy, to regain your energy, to renew your energy, I should say, and really start to regain your life. The last thing that I'll add with those two is, you know, that goes along with number one in that in shedding the weight vest. So shedding the 20 pounds, 30 pounds, 60, 80, 100 pounds that you're carrying up every flight of stairs, every time you walk out to your car to get in it, you're carrying that weight vest. Starting there can help you lose those pounds. Okay, so number three is reduce your stress. And stress hormones is what I put here because I wanted to really dive into what stress means. Take a drink of water, excuse me. So you definitely have to follow up on the webinar that we have on this because this is a deep, deep topic. And within this topic, there's just a lot going on. So what we're going to talk about right now is more skimming the surface, reducing your stress and reducing your stress hormones. Now, I say stress hormones because stress is a response from your body. So, you know, if one person, you know, is really affected by getting a bad grade on an exam, let's say, one person gets a C, and they're just destroyed. One person gets a C and they're elated. That is their response. And that is a choice with mental stress. You can change the way that you choose to respond. And we all have programs and we all have, you know, things that we've learned that program the way that we respond. You know, if you come from a high achieving, you know, strict family, maybe that C would just devastate because you know you're gonna get in trouble. But if you're from a family that's more, hey, you know, just do your best. Whatever you can do is great, and we're happy with that. Not to say that one's better than the other. Any meaning on that program. But mental stress. And I'm going to talk about really that you have mental stress. Okay, bad grade, bad bill, bad fight with your spouse, bad, you know, get yelled at by your boss, bad driver, bad, you know, parking lot at the mall, bad, you know, that type of adult mental anger stress, or childhood stress to my 2-year-olds. They get a lot of that. The second one, though, is physical stress. And you get in a car accident, you have an old injury, you sit at a desk for, you know, 8 hours a day, 40 hours a week, 10 years straight. That is a huge, huge physical stress, number two. And then number three is toxic stress. Okay, that comes from a sedentary lifestyle. It comes from not eating a real food diet. It comes from not exercising enough. Because then those help, you know, stabilize your body's detoxification systems. And this is another one of our steps, is to detoxify. So I'm not going to get into it in dramatic detail right now, but you have mental, physical, and chemical stress, and they all create the same stress response in your body. Okay, and so this is the main hormone involved with this is called called cortisol. Cortisol is your main stress hormone, and it's secreted by the adrenal glands, which is another step that we're going to go into further. But if you can reduce this stress response, if you can reduce your stress hormones, then you're going to reduce, this zaps your adrenals, which zaps your energy. Okay, so stress through a couple of different mechanisms that we're going to get into in about 5 to 10 minutes here, stress zaps your energy, but it's mental stress, it's physical stress, and it's toxic chemical stress. So a couple things that you can do to reduce those stress hormones, you can do meditation, you can do prayer, you can do deep breathing exercises, you can do yoga. There's a lot that you can do to reduce stress hormones. You can do mindset training where you just, change the way that you think about things, okay? That doesn't happen overnight. You can do positive affirmations. You can do, changing the way that you respond to things. You can do binaural brain waves. There's a ton of different things. I'm just shooting off the top of my head. You can also listen to some of our past podcasts and read some of our past articles about stress and the stress response, but you have to reduce that stress load on a daily basis to get your energy back. Even if you eat a real food diet and you exercise regularly, physical, chemical, and emotional stress, that's like the overtraining. It's too much physical stress. Too much stress is gonna zap you. Now, if you eat a real food diet and you exercise regularly, your resilience to stress is gonna be a lot higher than, say, a normal, typical, average working adult, but stress can get anybody, physical, chemical, or emotional. So you have to reduce your stress hormones. You have to take that under control. So stay tuned for that webinar also. Another thing I'll mention with that is they say that stresses every day, daily stresses, they're not gonna kill you, but it's like adding rocks to your backpack, and every time you add rocks to your backpack, you are making it harder, making everything harder, and that's like wearing the weight vest, making everything harder. So the next one, number four, is reset your sleep cycles. This is huge. This is probably the most obvious what thing that zaps your energy. If you just sleep poorly, say 2-3 nights in a row, it's very, very obvious that you're going to be fatigued or you're going to be really tired, right? And we've all felt that where we just didn't sleep properly or we woke up in the wrong sleep cycle, okay? So as you sleep, your body cycles through different stages, okay? And if you have poor sleep, then you better stay tuned to step number four, reset your sleep cycles webinar as it comes up, because we're going to get into these cycles in detail. But if you wake up in that wrong cycle, you're gonna be groggy, you're gonna have a hard time getting yourself out of bed. Whereas if you wake up in the right cycle, you're gonna be alert, you're gonna be awake, you're gonna be active, and we all know what that feels like. So we all, I think, know that sleep happens in cycles as well. And just like your cycles can get off, your cycles can be reset too. So we're gonna go into detail with that. One of the things that you can do is what's called mind your melatonin, okay? And we know melatonin, most people, as it being an over-the-counter sleep supplement. And I'm relatively okay with it being used from time to time. I think that using it regularly is not the best. What they've actually found with melatonin, when you take it all the time, it doesn't make your body produce less, actually, but what it does is it reduces your body's sensitivity to it. So your body, you have to take more and more, or your body has to produce more and more. It's just not as hormone sensitive as you continue taking it. But you can exercise to change your melatonin. You can eat foods to change your melatonin. You can turn off your screens to change your melatonin. So that's gonna be really the focus of that webinar number four, step number four, reset your sleep cycles. But the number one thing that I think can be done to reset sleep cycles is change the time that you wake up. Okay, because so often, we don't have much control over the time that we go to bed. We have control over what time we go to bed, but oftentimes we don't have control of what time we fall asleep. especially if our sleep cycles are off. That's what happens with many people. They're groggy in the morning, but they're wide awake at night. So change the time that you wake up. Start waking up earlier on a regular basis. Eventually, your body's going to be starving for sleep. And that's not a good thing to starve your body of sleep, but you understand the concept of as long as you continue to wake up at a consistent time, you're going to get tired earlier. Now, there's other action steps to take. I'm not promising that you're all of a sudden going to start being awake in the morning and asleep at night, but to start to regulate your cycles, that's the best thing that you can control. Because you might say, I'm going to go to bed at 8 o'clock tonight. And you go to bed at 8 o'clock, but your body's used to going to bed at 10:30, you're not going to fall asleep at 8:30 probably. You're going to lay there wide awake. We all know that feeling. We all hate that feeling of laying there wide awake, just wishing that we could fall asleep. So resetting your sleep cycles is a huge, huge part of regaining your energy. You should have a time where you fall asleep. You should have a time where you wake up. And if your sleep cycles are set, for most people, if, say, you didn't set your alarm clock, you still wake up at that time because your sleep cycles are so embedded into your body's programming that you just know what time to wake up and you wake up feeling rested. Now, the magic question is, what do I sleep on and how long do I sleep? And we'll cover that in the webinar. There's some really interesting sleep stats today because of everybody wearing Fitbits. They say they've gotten more sleep data in the last 5 to 10 years than they've gotten in the last 5 to 10 decades combined because all the sleep data gets sent in. So there's some really interesting facts there. And as far as what to sleep on, you know, that's a $1 million question, especially for a chiropractor. I have a preference. But I also don't use my preference because I like the bed that I have. But when I upgrade or when it's time for a new one, be more of a lateral move, but when I need a new one, I'm definitely going to go with an IntelliBed. So IntelliBed is the brand that I like the most for three reasons. Number one, it has great spinal support, which is hugely important. Number two, it's non-toxic, which is, you know, as important. I put those two on par with each other. You spend a third of your life on your mattress. If you're breathing in flame retardants, if you're breathing in fumes, which are really potent in mattresses, they do what's called something called off-gassing, which you're just taking that in all the time. And number three, IntelliBed has an awesome warranty. They're very, very long lasting. But you have to reset your sleep cycles. I always tell patients, they want to know, should I sleep on a hard surface? Should I sleep on a soft? I say, whatever you can sleep on. Whatever you can sleep on, whatever you're comfortable enough to fall asleep on, you feel like you're supported. Now, there's different things about the best sleeping position on your back, second best on your side, worst on your stomach. But I'm going to go into detail on those on the next webinar. Dun, 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 dun. Number five, detoxify your body and your life. Okay, and those two are, you know, those can easily be a webinar unto themselves because that's, you know, just a hugely deep topic today. Okay, so we're bombarded with toxins. Like many of you might not have known that you're getting toxins from your mattresses. And they continue to find these, by the way, in kids' mattresses. Flame retardants, things that are linked to cancer, finding them in kids' mattresses, kids' pajamas, because no company wants their pajamas to catch on fire and get a lawsuit. But there's nothing, you know, proving that these carcinogenic ingredients are going to cause cancer. It's something that might contribute 10, 20, 30 years down the road. But as for me and my kids, we stay away from those. But that might fall into the category of detoxify your life. Okay, get rid of your personal care products. And you know, one of the resources for this, www.realhealthresource.com. We have podcasts on the top 10 most toxic ingredients in personal care products. We have some YouTube videos on toxins in your everyday home things. We have webinars on toxicity and natural ways to detox, or excuse me, not webinars, but workshops on our podcast, audio recordings of our workshops, where we talk about where these toxins are at. They're in your food, okay? So eating a real food diet, there's a ton of them in your food. It's probably the number one source. They're in the air, they're in your tap water, They're in your personal care products. They're in your kids' plastic toys. They're in your kids' flame retardant footy pajamas. They're in your pillow. They're in, you know, pretty much everywhere you look. And that's not to say, we always encourage people that's not to say that, my gosh, the world is falling in on us. We do have, you know, 80,000 different chemicals in use in our industrialized society. So it is a huge, huge problem, but it's not to say that there's not a solution. The solution is just not filling your bucket as rapidly. So detoxifying your life, changing some of these things over, maybe getting a water filter, getting an air filter, starting to eat a real food diet, changing out to some organic clothing and bedding and food, and just detoxifying your life. But for most of us, for adults especially, we need to work on detoxifying our bodies, because the concern with the toxins in our life isn't that we're exposed to them and then we're exposed to them again and we're exposed to them again and we're just exposed so often. That is the concern, but the concern is that they accumulate. Okay, so just like filling the bucket, as you fill it, the levels rise. We're going to go into this analogy quite a bit on the webinar, of course, but as you continue filling with toxins, the bucket rises because those toxins accumulate. Now, your body's really, really efficient at detoxing. Your liver, your kidneys. We actually have a podcast out that's top 10 foods for natural detox. And your body is really efficient at detoxing and amazing at detoxing. Every one of your cells is designed to. We also have a podcast that's glutathione, your body's master detoxifier and antioxidant. So listen to those podcasts, learn more about your body's natural ways of detoxing. But in today's society, with the lifestyle that most people live today, they're overloading their body faster than they can detoxify. And it's zapping their energy, okay? Toxicity zaps your body's cellular energy. It causes inflammation. It causes weight gain. It destroys your body's ability to properly detoxify, to properly function, to properly be hormone sensitive, and it zaps your energy. Fatigue, brain fog, you know, there are people out there that have great sleep cycles, that eat a great diet, that exercise regularly, that are doing almost everything right, and the problem is that they're toxic. They have toxins that they don't know about, that have accumulated, that have zapped their energy. It's actually a really common cause of things like chronic fatigue, of fibromyalgia, and many of these patients have done everything and they're just not seeing that right under their nose, they're incredibly toxic. Those toxins store in the brain. They store in the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland, which we're going to talk about, I think, in the next step, maybe the step after that. But the hypothalamus and the pituitary, which control the adrenals, which control the thyroid, which control your body's ability to produce energy. So you have to detoxify your life, change some lifestyle things, you know, use a good company like Pure Haven Essentials. That's what we use for a lot of our like toothpaste and chapsticks and my wife lotion and makeup remover and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Pure Haven Essentials. Or, you know, just make your own at home is a great resource, but you have to detoxify your life. And for so many of us, we have to dump our bucket. We have to detoxify our bodies. Okay, so the next five are, we're really getting into, I would say, more detail. And we've already gotten into quite a bit of detail. So these first five webinars, you got to stay tuned for these first five webinars. Eat a real food diet. Number two, exercise regularly and the right amount. Number three, reduce your stress hormones. Steps one, two, and three, massively important, will massively transform your energy. If you're already doing those three, maybe you need to reset your sleep cycles. That's number four. And number five, detoxify your body and your life. Now, I wanted to recap those because there's not a single person that can't improve their energy by doing those first five. Not a single person that's not going to improve. But if you remember the first slides we went through, people with diagnosed thyroid conditions, people with chronic fatigue, people with fibromyalgia, people with depression, people with diabetes, or you know, a chronic disease they're going to need to go a few steps further. So yes, the first five steps are a must. Like I said, they go in specific order. You can't do step six without doing steps 1 through 5 and so on and so forth. But steps 6 through 10 are getting into a little bit more clinical detail. And so if you're somebody out there that's suffering, that you have fibro, that you have thyroid, hypothyroid, your energy is off, you're wired at night, you can't go to sleep, but you're tired in the morning, then it's time to look a little bit further. So steps 6 through 10, that's what we're going to talk about, or what you can do to look a few steps further and dig a little bit. Step number 6, heal and seal your leaky gut. Healing and sealing your leaky gut is massively important. One of the things, you know, they're finding that gut health is related to, you know, pretty much everything under the sun. And we have an awesome webinar on this, on leaky gut. We have an ebook that goes along with it, The Real Health Leaky Gut Protocol. We have a recipe book that goes along with that, The Real Health Leaky Gut Recipes book. So together, what they show you is a protocol that you can do to help heal and seal your leaky gut. But the gut is your body's, you know, first defense when you're eating food, to keeping good stuff, letting good stuff in to your body, to your cells, vitamins, minerals, keeping bad stuff out. So when you have a leaky gut, you're not only letting good stuff in, but you're letting bad stuff in. The root cause of disease, if you have a diagnosed autoimmune disease, I would strongly encourage you, or even if you don't, because they estimate that 85% of the population has some form of autoimmunity, but you know, good percentage of those don't know it, 40-some percent of those. If you have any of those, you need to watch those webinars. But that's letting bad stuff in, letting toxins in. And as we just talked about, toxins fuel inflammation. They're going to slow down your hormonal response. They're going to cause weight gain. But they're also just going to cause immune dysfunction. And one of the biggest, you know, symptoms of a leaky gut is actually fatigue and low energy. Okay, and so it's sometimes just as simple as switching your probiotic or taking a probiotic will boost your energy dramatically. So what I recommend, I have it right here, is a product called Prescriptassist. Okay, Prescriptassist is the best probiotic on the market. We sell it on our website, we sell it in our store. But Prescriptassist is a supplement that I strongly recommend to anybody with fatigue. Unless they come in and they say, you know, I've taken a probiotic for the last 6 months, then, you know, we might have to look somewhere else and continue working on these other 9 steps. But for the most part, healing and sealing your leaky gut will have an immediate impact on your energy. And I'll show you exactly what this means. When we talk about the gut lining, this is the gut lining. I think you guys can see my mouse right now, but this is the gut lining. And this is the bloodstream, that red thing that looks like an artery. Okay, so that's your bloodstream. So you want to keep these things up at the top. You want to keep all those out. You want to keep food issues like gluten. You want to keep that out. Casein from dairy, you want to keep that out. Or you want it to be properly broken down, at least, before it gets through these gut linings, these holes in your gut. Remember, we use the analogy of a screened-in porch. And it's like poking holes in your screen, a leaky gut is. So things get in there, toxins get in there, parasites get in there, food particles, big proteins that aren't broken down, get through your leaky gut into your bloodstream and cause these problems. Food intolerances, which is the first step towards autoimmunity. They can get across the blood-brain barrier. They can poke holes in your bloodstream where things aren't supposed to be able to get into your brain, but then they're able to get into your brain. They cause inflammation and immune dysregulation, which inflammation is an immune response. So when you have chronic inflammation, you have an immune function, and it can lead to autoimmunity, nutrient absorption issues. All these things are caused by a leaky gut. So healing and sealing your leaky gut, massively important to change your energy. And for a lot of people out there, if you're having any autoimmune condition, you're having any chronic fatigue, fibromyalgia type symptoms, even something like migraines, heal and seal your leaky gut. Skin problems. Skin problems are a huge thing that people say, well, my gut and my skin, like, how can those be related to my acne or my rosacea or my psoriasis? But they absolutely are. So healing and sealing your leaky gut. This is also important for kids, I will say, that they maintain a good gut. You know, I wouldn't say that my 2.5-year-olds have a leaky gut, but we take gut health very seriously, and we have ever since their natural vaginal birth. That's a really important thing for a child's gut. But they ate sauerkraut. They still love sauerkraut. They occasionally take probiotic here or there, not every day. But the number one thing they do is the number one thing in this podcast, or this webinar rather, they eat a real food diet. Okay, and so by not introducing these fake foods, they don't eat hardly any gluten or wheat or glyphosate, because they eat a mostly organic diet. It keeps their gut integrity intact, and it's not going to lead to things, and hopefully, no guarantees, no promises, but lead to things like asthma, like allergies, like chronic colds, like sinus infections, like acne, like depression, like autism, like ADHD. All these things are linked to your gut health, very heavily, heavily linked. And our hope and our prayer is that by keeping our kids' guts healthy, we're going to avoid some of these, modern day epidemics. So if you're an adult and you think you have a leaky gut, you have to heal and seal it, especially if you want, full energy that we're talking about in this webinar. Number 7, support your adrenal glands and your HPA axis. Okay, and I put that under there because some of you maybe have heard of adrenal fatigue or adrenal burnout. I've talked about it. Many people have talked about it. What they're suggesting now is that because the medical literature doesn't necessarily support that. And I'll give you an example of this. The scientific name for those is HPA axis dysfunction. Okay, HPA, the H stands for the hypothalamus. That's up in your brain. I'll actually show you a picture of it. Actually, I'll go ahead and pull up a picture of it right now just so you can see it. Because the hypothalamus, we say that it's like the sensor on your thermostat. Okay, it senses what is the temperature in the room. If the thermostat's set to 69 and the hypothalamus senses that it is 67, it's going to send a message to the furnace. The furnace is going, or to the thermostat. The thermostat is going to send a message to the furnace. The furnace is going to kick heat out. So the picture is actually on step number 9. We're skipping ahead. But look here, this is the thyroid. And so the thyroid and the adrenal glands are both controlled by the hypothalamus at the top there, the pituitary, the next one down, and then that next arrow that goes to the thyroid. We could have another picture up here having it go to the adrenal gland. So that's HPA axis, hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. There's an HPT axis, which is what we just saw with the thyroid. Also goes out to the reproductive glands to help produce testosterone and estrogen. But your adrenal glands are the workhorses of your body's energy. They really are. They're about the size of a walnut, about the size of maybe smaller than your thumb. And they sit on top of your kidneys, and they control your body's energy production. And they produce this hormone called cortisol that we mentioned earlier. They also produce some other hormones, epinephrine, norepinephrine, DHEA. But they're produced from the adrenal glands. And essentially, the idea is that as your adrenals are the workhorses of your body's energy system, pretend like you're in a carriage and there's two horses pulling you, and you just keep whipping them and whipping them and whipping them and whipping them. Well, horses can't go forever, and neither can adrenal glands that aren't supported. So as you keep whipping them with your stress load, with your work hours, you're working 60-hour work weeks, you have a stressful relationship on top of that. After your 60-hour work weeks, you come home and you fight with your spouse. Then you throw on top of that every single morning, every single night, you sleep about, you know, 6 hours, even though your body really requires more like, for you personally, 8.5, let's say. Then every morning, because of that, you have 2 cups of coffee, 2 big cups of strong coffee, and you're just whipping your adrenals, you're whipping your adrenals, you're whipping your adrenals. Then that becomes 3 cups of coffee. Then it becomes 4. That's a sign that your adrenals are starting to fatigue. They're starting to fatigue, and the end result of fatigue is burnout. So we've always used these terms, adrenal fatigue and adrenal burnout, but I'm being strongly discouraged now from using those moving forward, because the more scientific term is HPA axis dysfunction. And so even our adrenal profile tests that we do in the office, they're now called HPA axis dysfunction tests. And I want to show you an example of one of those, because we do test this. This is something that can be tested. And what it does, I'll just pull up the slide. You test it over the course of 24 hours, over a day. Okay, and so here is a test. And if you'll see that the X's are the upper range and the squares are the lower range. So the two gray lines are the upper and lower where somebody should fall. Okay, where this patient was at is the purple line. So you can see right when they woke up in the morning, you wanna take one when you're awake. Actually, it's 5 times throughout the day. You take one 30 minutes after you awake, and then you take one 60 minutes after you awake. I guess it's 6. It used to be 4. But waking 30 minutes and 60 minutes. This is actually a new thing, the cortisol awakening response, because they say that the most important time to check is within the first 60 minutes of waking up and looking for this spike. So this is something that's actually brand new in the literature and brand new in our testing that just recently changed. But so at the beginning of the day, your cortisol is at its highest. That's your stress hormone. Then as you go through the day, it should drop dramatically by noon and continue dropping until you go to bed. Now you can see that this person, they're very low in the morning, and then they stay low, low through the afternoon. But then at nighttime, they're high. So their cortisol rhythm is being thrown off. They're low in the morning and they're high at night. That is an early sign of adrenal dysfunction. And there's, you know, at the webinar on this, we will get into a lot of detail, because there's several different presentations. There's wired and tired. There's what I would still call, because of illustration purposes, adrenal fatigue, where the adrenals are just fatigue, they're just not working as well as they should be, you're just low. Then there's adrenal burnout, where you're just, you know, hardly on the charts and they're not hardly doing anything at all. This is going to affect somebody's sleep cycles. It's going to affect their ability to gain or lose weight. It's going to affect their perceived stress. It's going to affect basically everything. So the action step for this, this is, you know, massively, massively important for somebody that's done some of the other action steps. They're eating a real food diet, they're exercising, they try to sleep well, but they can't. They try to reduce their stress, but they can't. The smallest little thing makes them go off the edge, or they feel like they've kind of lost their emotions. This is somebody that needs to look into supporting their adrenal glands. I'll tell you, I just finished an adrenal support protocol without doing the testing, just because I felt like I needed it. So that is something that everybody can do, but it's also something that if you feel like you really need it, then you need to get tested. You need to get tested. I can't understate the importance of this test, of the HPA axis dysfunction test. Number 8 is balance your neurotransmitters. And your neurotransmitters are your brain's communicators. Okay, so they control a lot of things like energy. And probably the best example is mood. So when we talked about depression, one of the major signs being lethargy or fatigue, or you just don't want to get out of bed in the morning. That is an imbalance in neurotransmitters. That's something that's happening in your brain. Now your gut makes a lot of neurotransmitters, but they're different than the neurotransmitters in your brain. But they're intimately connected. The gut is what's considered the second brain, and that's one of the reasons why. But the best example is serotonin. Serotonin controls your mood. It's a neurotransmitter, and it's why a lot of Prozacs and Zolofts and different antidepressants are what's called selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. They inhibit the uptake of serotonin, keep it out there floating, increase serotonin so that it boosts your mood. Another big one is dopamine. That one controls concentration and focus, and it's what most people think of as an adrenaline junkie sometimes is really a dopamine junkie. And adrenaline is what's called epinephrine and norepinephrine, produced by the adrenals. They're all very, very interrelated. This is another thing that, this webinar is where we're really going to talk about this. If you feel like you have imbalanced neurotransmitters, a lot of times it goes along with the adrenals. You're wired at night, you can't go to bed, but you're just groggy in the morning, you can't get moving. As with all 10 of these steps to regain your energy, to renew your energy, rather, all 10 of these steps, they're all interrelated very, very intimately. But for some people, and this is based on, I wouldn't say to self-diagnose this. This would be based on taking a history and working with, a practitioner who thinks that this is something that really needs to be addressed. But I'll show you a test that we look at for this. This is called neurobiogenic amines, which is neurotransmitters. So there's dopamine, like we mentioned. There's norepinephrine and epinephrine, like we mentioned. There's serotonin. There's tyrosine. There's GABA. Okay, GABA right in the middle. That is your body's main calming neurotransmitter. So you may have been to a health food store and seen GABA, on the shelf there and say, oh, GABA calm. It helps calm you down. That's a neurotransmitter that, if you're not calm, why? What's causing your GABA to be off? Is it off? This person here, theirs was right down the middle. Their glutamate was high, which is excitatory, a very excitatory neurotransmitter. Their tyrosine is high, taurine and glycine are high, and histamine is relatively high. Whereas their norepinephrine, their epinephrine, their serotonin were all a little bit on the lower end. So anyway, I'm not going to diagnose this here or talk any more about the findings of this, but that's something that, if you feel like you've done all the other steps, sometimes balancing your neurotransmitters, resetting your neurotransmitters is something that's going to help. Now, how can you do that, just in a couple action steps? Well, you can reset your sleep. You can support your adrenals. You can eat a real food diet. You can exercise regularly. Exercise is probably the number one thing to support and balance healthy neurotransmitter function, healthy brain function. Exercises like pouring Miracle-Gro on your brain. So if you're taking all these steps and you still feel like you have these imbalances, then it's time to look a little deeper. But these steps that we've already gone through are also the solution. So all these things, like I said, are intimately connected. So wrapping up here, number 9 is fix your thyroid. And the word fix, wasn't the best choice because sometimes, your thyroid has been, you've taken Synthroid for 20 years and your thyroid just might not produce thyroid hormone the way that it used to. Or maybe you've had some part of your thyroid removed or something like that. But fixing your thyroid, supporting your thyroid is so incredibly important to energy. It's a modern day epidemic. So many women, especially that we see come into the office, are on a thyroid medication. And because it is relatively easily treatable, if your TSH is 10 and we give you Synthroid and your TSH comes down to 4, then let's see you back in 6 months and make sure that it's still at 4 and you can stay on that dosage of Synthroid for the rest of your life until you tell us that you're starting to have problems and then we'll bump the dosage up. It's relatively easily treatable, But make sure that you watch our thyroid webinar, because one of the biggest problems with the thyroid epidemic is the testing and the medicating and not really looking for the true cause. And I've seen dozens of people get off their thyroid medication naturally. And the sooner that you find out about it, the easier it is. But it's a huge, huge problem with your energy production. If you feel like you're lethargic or you feel like you're jittery, if you feel like your energy is imbalanced in either way, now this is, you know, like I said, the time to talk to a practitioner, to get a good history, to take a detailed history and know exactly what's going on, what symptoms you're experiencing, what brings them on, what helps them, when they started, what you've done in the past, all these really, really, really important things that help us put the pieces of the puzzle together. This is not the time to self-diagnose by any means, but watch that webinar to learn a little bit more about the problems with the current diagnostic criteria and the current treatment options, where there might be some holes in that and what you can do to support that. So I'm gonna show you a couple of, you know, you already saw this one image, but this is what happens. The hypothalamus, remember that's the sensor of your thermostat. It says our temperature, the temperature in this room is too low. It sends a message to the pituitary, that's the thermostat. The pituitary sends, is either going to send signals to the furnace or it's going to send signals to the air conditioner. But at this time, the temperature in the room is too low. So it's going to send a signal to the thyroid and say, we need more thyroid hormone. So that signal is called TSH. And that's the only thing that they base your medication off of, is where your TSH is at. Unless you've got a really good doctor or, you know, you're looking into something like Hashimoto's, sometimes they'll just guess that it's Hashimoto's without doing the testing at all. But anyway, then your thyroid produces thyroid hormone. Okay, thyroid hormone is called T4. That's that big T4 right there. I'm pointing to it on my screen with my finger and realizing that you guys can't see that. T4, that's inactive. Okay, so your body can't use that. It can't get into the cells, which is where you want it to be. Every single cell in your body has receptors for thyroid hormone. That's how important it is. T4 needs to be converted to T3 by the liver and by the gut, and converted there. Your thyroid does produce some T3, just not as much, but it needs to be converted into the active form T3, and that needs to get into the cell. So if we're only checking TSH, it's not telling us, is there a problem with the thyroid gland? Is there a problem with the liver? Is there a problem with the gut? Is there autoimmunity? Do we need to test for antibodies for autoimmunity? It's not telling us these things. And if you look at the factors that can affect thyroid function, and it's the same factors really that affect adrenal function, but the thyroid, I'd say, is a little more susceptible to toxins, things like fluoride, bromines, heavy metals, and also nutrient deficiencies, nutrient imbalances, you know, not enough iodine, not enough B vitamins, not enough selenium is a really important one for your thyroid. So there's a lot of factors that affect your thyroid function. It's important that you understand what's going on with your thyroid so that you can get it corrected. And medication, I do not believe, is the answer. And then number 10, restore your cellular energy. And this is important to note that it's made up of a bunch of different cells. It's about, you know, 50 to 75 trillion cells in your entire body, and each one produces their own energy, and that collectively makes up your body's energy. So like I said, every cell in your body has receptors for thyroid hormone, really, really important. But the most important thing with restoring your cellular energy is something called your mitochondria, okay? And so if you have, and this is the people that we talked about at the beginning, the chronic fatigue, the fibromyalgia, the brain fog, the CME, the tired all the time syndrome. That's a real thing. Mitochondrial dysfunction, mitochondrial disease. You can Google it if you want to, if you don't want to wait for the webinar, but you need to stay tuned for that webinar. It's a super important topic today. I've even seen mitochondrial dysfunction that I believe has been caused by a vaccine. In a 16-year-old girl, did some lab work on her, definitely had mitochondrial dysfunction, showed up in several different urinary organic acid biomarkers, that her energy production pathways weren't functioning properly. And I believe it was linked to the Gardasil vaccine. Heavy in aluminum. Aluminum damages the mitochondria. Heavy metals damage the mitochondria. Bad fats damage the mitochondria. They say that mitochondria, I don't know how many more times I can say that word, they say that it's responsible for 90% of the body's energy. Every single one of your cells has hundreds to thousands to possibly even 10,000 in your cell that produce your energy. And what they're responsible for is metabolism. Everybody has heard the word metabolism. Oh, they have a fast metabolism, they have a slow metabolism. Metabolism is the study of the mitochondria, because they use two things for energy. They use sugar and they use fat. They produce energy. If you've been through any science classes, even maybe in high school, the Krebs cycle, the citric acid cycle, the electron transport chain, you remember the mitochondria are the powerhouses of your body's energy. Toxins damage mitochondria. Exercise builds mitochondria. Real food diet supports mitochondria. Detoxifying your life and your body supports mitochondria. There's different supplements that you can take that actually can support the biogenesis of mitochondria. They can create more. In fact, there's one that we'll talk about in the webinar that the United States Olympic Committee had to meet on because they wanted to see, is this illegal? Because it's boosting people's times, it's helping them set personal records, because they're boosting mitochondria, and the mitochondria produce the energy and giving them an athletic competitive edge. But in so many of our chronic diseases today, this is why this is number 10. This is the heaviest topic of all. This is somebody that, you know, knows they have a problem typically. They've been diagnosed, they've been medicated. It's not like I need to lose 20 pounds. It's not like I need to go to the gym and I can get back on track. It's somebody whose life has been destroyed and ruined by something like chronic fatigue, like fibro, like chronic migraines, et cetera. Chronic diseases, autoimmune diseases today, they are caused by mitochondrial dysfunction. And the number one thing that I would say that you can do is detoxify. These toxins that get stored inside your cells, if they're never gotten rid of, if they're never detoxed, if they're never, you know, healed, if they're never, you know, your body doesn't spit those out, then you're always going to have inflammation of your cellular membranes, inflammation of your mitochondria, and you're never going to be able to regain your energy. So in our True Cellular Detox program, 90-day program, which, you know, for most people in this state, 90 days is not going to do it. 90 days is a start. But you might need to repeat this 3-month cycle time after time after time. Right now, I'm repeating the brain phase, which is phase number 3 of the 3 months. There's a preparatory phase, there's a body phase, and there's a brain phase. And these toxins get stored in the brain. They affect the mitochondria. They affect the hypothalamus. They affect the pituitary, which, as you know, after today's webinar, will affect the adrenals, will affect the gut, will affect the thyroid. They're all intimately connected. It will throw off the neurotransmitters. It's going to throw off your whole life. And this is the epidemic today. And there are supplements in the True Cellular Detox program that not only get rid of the toxins, bind the toxins and get rid of them, but there are supplements in there that support your mitochondria, that rebuild your cellular membranes, strengthen your cells, the 5 R's of cellular healing, get your cells detoxifying again, get your cells producing energy again, and support these systems. So True Cellular Detox, you know, really addresses all 10 of these issues. I think the chiropractic is, you know, one of the most important things that you can do is get adjusted, reducing your physical stress, reducing your stress response. But with all 10 steps with low energy, true cellular detox, an amazing, amazing program to fix these things. Stay tuned as we move forward with these next 10 webinars, okay? Now you can also look into our Real Health Coaching Program. That's something that I would encourage you to do as you learn more. Real Health Coaching Program, a monthly coaching program that involves Skype calls, just like this, you know, video calls, whichever system you use. Google Calls is what I prefer, actually, Google Hangouts. But a video call and some coaching as to how to implement these steps. You know, like I said, steps one through five, most people can implement. Eat, you know, exercise, eat a real food diet, start changing your sleep patterns, start working on some of these more basic steps, reducing your stress, meditating, praying, start working on some of these more basic steps. But for the people that really know that they're struggling, you know that you're struggling, you're taking a medication, you want to change it, you've tried this, you've tried that, you've gotten advice from everywhere, you don't need another doctor, you don't need another treatment, you don't need another pill. What you need is a coach. What you need is a coach to walk you through this and guide you, take your health history, piece the pieces of the puzzle together, and give you the steps that you need to take in order, and then be your accountability partner as you're doing those. So the Real Health Resource, www.realhealthresource.com, has all the content that you need to begin putting these action steps into place. You can watch past podcasts, past webinars on blood sugar control, on real food diet, on stress load, on detoxifying, on exercising, you know, all these important topics. But for so many people, what you need is a coach to hold your hand and to walk you through this. So we have an affordable coaching program that's where many of you are at. And so if that's where you're at, make sure you go to www.realhealthresource.com. Sign up for that. Let us help you. I'll pull that website up one more time. But otherwise, thank you for tuning in. Stay tuned as we continue and go through each of these 10 steps in detail. If there was one that stuck out to you, please send us an email. Please share with us on Facebook. Please share with us on realhealthresource.com. And let us know which one you want to hear about the most. But those are going to come out in order, so stay tuned for those. And we're excited for this next year, and we'll see you on the next webinar.